So we're in Matthew's Gospel, the 9th chapter. We're starting off in verse 14. We're just going to go through verse 17. All right, everybody's ready. It says, "Then John's disciples came and asked Jesus, 'How is it that we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples do not fast?' Jesus answered, 'How can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them? The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. Then they will fast. No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. Neither do people pour new wine into old wineskins. If they do, the skins will burst. The wine will run out, and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins, and they both are preserved.'" Some pretty interesting examples that Jesus throws in there. Not many contemporary ones, maybe, but good examples nonetheless. You know, in life, in our year, as we go through our year, there's oftentimes some pretty good days which you might want to diet, you might want to fast, like following New Year's, you might want to diet, you know, that's kind of a common thing. But there are some days throughout the year that you definitely don't want to be dieting, you certainly don't want to be fasting. You can think of a few. Your birthday, for one. You don't want to fast on your birthday. It's a celebration. You have to celebrate, you know, merrymaking, eating birthday cake. You can't fast on your birthday, can you? Or how about the 4th of July? You definitely don't want to fast on the 4th of July. The barbecue, are you kidding me? We're celebrating our nation's birthday. We're celebrating our independence. We can't fast on the 4th of July. How about, you know, Christmas? You know, we always have ham on Christmas. We have turkey on Thanksgiving, ham on Christmas, mashed potatoes. Okay, we're getting closer to lunchtime, so I don't want to go on a big list, but there are some things and some days you don't want to fast. Well, my favorite holiday is coming up in less than 30 days. It's Thanksgiving. It's a day that you do not want to be fasting. Because, one, Thanksgiving is a celebration of God's goodness to you. And if you fast on a day that you're celebrating God's goodness to you, it's very rude. And dare I say, sinful. Because God has been good to you, and you celebrate that goodness by eating from the abundance that he has provided. You don't fast. How rude. Well, John's disciples have come to Jesus, and they're not pleased with what they see. They see Jesus is feasting with sinners and tax collectors and not fasting like the Pharisees, and they are. Jesus' ministry, in fact, seems to be kind of popping. It seems cool. The new prophet has like a bounce in his step, if you will. And they're having fun, and they're going to dinner parties, and they're celebrating with people. It's the liberating work that's been taking place, and it's making the Jews, the religiously serious, feel really uncomfortable. And so they're starting to take notice in our text this morning. The lawyers, the Pharisees, and now John's disciples are starting to confront Jesus and his ministry. They're worried about his ministry practices. You're not doing things the way that we're supposed to be doing them, at least the way we think. And so this new thing that Jesus is doing is making them feel real uncomfortable. They think that Jesus should be a little bit more serious about his ministry. Take it a little more seriously. Do some of the spiritual disciplines, like fasting. That's what we start out with here in verse 14. It says, John's disciples came and asked him, "How is it that we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples do not fast?" You can add, "at all." fast often. In the Greek is roughly translated, we fast a lot. Fast a lot. And that actually might be a slightly important point, maybe not the main point, but it might reveal something about John's disciples at this time, that they were feeling like their fasting was really not a joy to them. It wasn't something that they loved to do, but it was something of a burden to them, something that also they were wearing as a badge of honor, as if we're better than you because we fast often. A sense of self-righteousness for their fasting. But these are John's disciples, and John was a great man of God, the greatest prophet that ever lived. And I don't want to assume too much. I don't want to assume automatically that their questioning of Jesus' disciples is laced with accusation. It may be, it may not be. But the question stands. They're asking Jesus a question. Why is it that we fast, but your disciples do not? So before we answer that question, or before we let Jesus answer that question, let's first answer this question. Why do people fast in the first place? What's the point of fasting? The first thing I want to say, and there's lots of reasons why people fast, including medical reasons. Like, if I had to get my blood drawn, I might have to fast before it. That way, whatever. They do whatever they do. They just tell me what to do, okay? But spiritual reasons, okay? The first one is for the spiritual discipline of fasting. And if you are fasting for the spiritual discipline of it, you might be doing it so that you would discipline your body. So it's a way of telling your body no for a specific purpose, so that you telling your spirit, you yes. You know, I'm master over my body. My body is not master over me. And I'm teaching it submission by not giving it something that it desperately wants, even needs. So that's one way of doing it. It's a spiritual discipline. You're saying that my new life is in control. Body of death, you are no longer in control. And, you know, just to tell you a story I once heard in seminary, it was that there was a man in seminary who once struggled, like, deeply with lust. And it wasn't until he took up the practice of regularly fasting did he actually overcome that struggle. Because it was the actual practice of him telling his body no that taught him how to tell his body no, right? Telling his body no in one thing that was good, now he could tell his body no in another thing that was bad. So it's one way of developing the spiritual self. It's a spiritual discipline. The second thing or reason why people will fast is to commemorate something or to remember something. So you, in the text here, the Jews often would fast to commemorate the destruction of the temple or commemorate the captivity in Babylon. They do this and they take on sackcloth and ashes and they mourn essentially in fasting because of that time of trouble, because of the destruction. Think of this as Christians, we do this too. Some of us will fast in the season of Lent as the 40 days where you prepare for your Easter time. You're commemorating, you're looking forward to something as well, right? You are preparing yourself spiritually for Easter, Good Friday, Easter, and thereby also preparing for the second coming. So, and then that leads me to the third reason why people will fast. It's to prepare themselves for something yet to come, something to get ready for, and that would be for Christians, for the coming day of the Lord. We prepare ourselves by, you know, fasting. So when the Lord is present, though, it wouldn't be a good time to prepare for his coming because he's already there. That's obvious. I don't even need to say that, but that's what is the problem in our text today. You see, in this text, John's disciples are preparing for the coming Messiah by fasting, and that light has dawned. The Messiah is there. And so that is why we don't fast. You see, Jesus explains this in verse 15 using an illustration. Jesus answered, "How can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them?" Then The time will come when the bridegroom's taken away. Then they can fast. Then they can go back to preparing for the bridegroom to return. This is the first of what three examples that come in the text that Jesus gives. And the first, he calls himself a bridegroom, or in our terms, he's the groom at the wedding. And as the groom, it's referring right back to Hosea chapter 2, verse 19, where it talks about the bridegroom being the Messiah. So he's directly telling these Jews, who would have known that passage in Hosea, that I am the Messiah. You can't mourn when the Messiah is here, because the Messiah is here. You can imagine how inappropriate it would be to fast at a wedding. Got two weddings coming up. And when you're with the bride and the groom, if you're putting on a funeral outfit and not eating and drinking and making merry, then that is rude. That is really rude. During the wedding is the time to celebrate, because the bride and the groom are in front of you. When they go away off to the honeymoon, okay. Mourn if you wish. You know, it's kind of like this stuff reminds me of when I go to sleep in a hotel room, which happens once or twice a year. And they have those curtains that are so thick that when you close them, you cannot see the light of day. Have you ever fallen asleep with those curtains like totally drawn? And then you wake up in the morning, you have no idea what time it is. It could be noon. It could be in the middle of the night. Finally, somebody, probably one of the kids in my case, will peel that curtain back and reveal the truth. It is the light of day, and it comes shining in rudely, you know. This is what it is like for Jesus and these disciples, is they've got the curtains drawn, and it's dark, and they're mourning, and they're waiting for the light of day to dawn on them, the Messiah's light. And Jesus comes in there, and he's like, guys, it's 12 noon. The light has been shining on you for 28 years. I've been here. Not time to mourn. It's not time to fast. It's time to feast and celebrate, even with tax collectors and sinners, because the salvation of my people is here, because their Savior is here. He says, mourn when the Messiah is taken away. Wait, what? Hold on a second. Did you catch that? These are John's disciples. And Jesus is already now teaching that the Messiah is going to be betrayed and crucified. You see that he's hinting at that super early in his ministry. Jesus is not surprised about the Father's plan for him. He sees, and he's teaching already, that the Messiah, or the bridegroom, is going to be taken away. That's not something that shows up in Hosea's prophecy. I guess that would be confusing to them. The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken away, then they will fast. So you don't want to take this text too far and say, because Jesus came, that means we will never ever fast, or we'll never participate in spiritual disciplines. No, see, Jesus knows that there's going to be a future in which it would be very appropriate to fast. There's going to be a time in which it'll be very appropriate to practice spiritual discipline. The time is coming when the groom is taken away, and when he's not there, it's going to be appropriate for you to remember and to prepare and to look forward to his coming. Yes, there's a time when fasting is appropriate, and there's a time when it's not. We as Christians, oftentimes, I definitely encourage this, the practice of fasting, especially during the season of Lent. And I know we're not even close to that season. We're like half a year away. But the thing about Lent is it's about preparing for Easter. It's about preparing for Jesus' death and resurrection. It's also looking forward to his second coming. And there is a way in which you would fast that would be absolutely inappropriate. It would be wrong. Just to kind of teach you, and this is maybe not the biggest point of the message, but during Lent, or during a time of fasting, the early church would never fast on Sunday. Never fast on Sunday, even during Lent. So they would have a 40-day of fasting, but they always break on Sunday. Do you know why that is? Fasting on Sunday is always wrong, in my opinion. Even dieting on Sunday, I say, is wrong. I'm not joking. I'm serious, dead serious. You should not diet on Sunday. It's wrong. You aren't supposed to, because Sunday is a festive day to the Lord. It is the day in which God comes among us and communes with us. It's the day that we are with the bridegroom. This is a day that he's meant to feast and celebrate with us. Do you know why we don't worship on the Sabbath anymore? You're like, I thought Sunday was a Sabbath. No, it's not. Friday evening, sundown. Saturday evening, sundown. That's the Sabbath period. We don't worship on the Sabbath anymore. We worship on Sunday. Do you know why? Because Jesus was raised to dead on the first day of the week. And so we together have this big celebration every Sunday. We get together and we celebrate this festive day because it is a day that the Lord was raised. And he's with us even now by his Spirit. And so no, we don't fast on Sunday. In fact, when we go home or when we go to the restaurant, we order big. I want seconds. We take it home. We heat it up later. We eat it again because it was good. We feel too full on Sundays because that is a picture of our Messiah, our Savior, who brings life and celebration, resurrection life to us. We don't diet on Sunday. It's meant to be a day of feast. It's new wine in this text. It's new cloth. Verse 16 says, no one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. Do you understand that illustration? Does that make sense to you? I'm not a seamstress, male seam person. Like, I don't sew. But I think it just makes sense. The cloth, if it's old, if you put like a new piece of cloth on it before you had washed it, so that when you wash it, it shrinks, it's just going to make the tear worse. Does that make sense? Okay, so Jesus is saying, that's why I'm not acting in the old ways, because the new has come. And if I try and put the new on top of the old, it's actually going to make the worse. He uses the second illustration. Neither do people pour new wine into old wineskins. If they do, the skins will burst. The wine will run out and the wineskins will be ruined. You got old wine and old wineskins. Fine. You don't take that wine after having drunk the wine, pour new wine in it. That way when it expands, it bursts and then everything is ruined. See, Jesus is saying we're doing something new. So we worship on the day that the Lord was raised, right? Instead of the old way, we do the new. We don't put new wine into old skin. Why don't we fast on Sunday? Well, because we don't mourn while we're with our groom. We don't act like we're at a funeral when we're at a wedding. If you want to fast on Sunday, this is my one caveat. You may fast on Sunday morning before the Lord's Supper. You take the Lord's Supper, and then you, for the rest of the day, are eating pie and cake and everything good and celebrating real big. Because this is the supper of our Lord, is dining with us. And when he dines with us, we celebrate. How rude would it be to come to the table and be like, not eating today, Lord. No, what you have provided for me, I'm not partaking. He has prepared a supper for us, and we will celebrate that supper. Why don't we circumcise as a sign of the covenant anymore? You're probably aware of this, right? That in order to enter into the first covenant, you were circumcised on the eighth day. We don't circumcise for the purpose of that. Still, people are circumcised today, but not to enter into the covenant. That is old wineskin. You don't pour new wine into old wineskin. So what's the sign of the covenant now today? It's baptism. Baptism's the new wineskin in which God has poured his new wine into the new covenant, you see. God is doing new things. And the temptation and the questions that John's disciples have is, how come you're doing things differently now? How come these things are changing? It's hard. We don't like change. We're professionals at not changing. What John's disciples needed to know, and we too, is that Jesus was doing something new, something refreshing among his people. And in that, what was he doing? He brought salvation. And that salvation came to the people freely by grace. It wasn't an if-then. If it wasn't that they had to bring their best, it was that God simply forgave them by his grace. And then that led those people to freedom and celebration, like the Matthew tax collector party, where people who are forgiven have come to celebrate big their forgiveness that they've received. And that forgiveness leads to freedom. Too many of us, I think, have forgotten that. I'm in that boat too. I'm not pointing any fingers, trust me. But I think that we have forgotten that. We have forgotten that salvation and forgiveness that comes through grace should lead to our freedom. And freedom leads to our celebration. Do you know, we are too often carrying around these just heavy loads, these heavy burdens that life it just deals. And so much so that joy seems to be very elusive in the life of Christians often. But I believe that Jesus would ask us to give our burdens to him, to allow him to carry the load so that we can experience the freedom and celebrate along with our Savior. I'm not saying that there isn't hard things in our week and we have just cause to grieve. There is. But we have the groom and he is always with us. And so we always have cause to celebrate. We always have cause to rejoice. So this is my call this Sunday. We are about to partake of the Lord's Supper. I would encourage you to call every Sunday from here on out Celebration Sunday. And no matter what is going on in your life, you dedicate that one day to celebrating the great freedom that you have in Jesus. Let's pray. Father, this day is a day that you have made, a day of great celebration and rejoicing. Thank you that you have put new wine into new wineskins. Lord, help us to celebrate, especially in the midst of hard times in our lives, but help us to always come back to the great, great Savior we have. Lord, we love you. Help this day to be great. In Jesus' name, amen.